Okay. I think we are broadcasting now. Mayor Regalado, welcome. My name's Elaine Chen, and I'm with WLRN Miami Herald News. I'm speaking with Miami Mayor Tomas Regalado as part of our If I Were Mayor project, which is supported by the Miami Foundation. Welcome, Mayor Regalado.
Good afternoon.
So I'm just going to start with some questions that I've gotten through ideas that we've received through our If I Were Mayor project. But for our online audience, if you have ideas or proposals for the mayor, please tweet WLRN with the hashtag If I Were Mayor, or you can also just fill it out below on the website that you're probably looking at right now. And we'll start there now. So Mayor Regalado, we've heard that Miami suffers from a brain drain, which is that people who are aged between 25 and 34 are not choosing to stay in Miami, and that Miami is not attracting enough young, educated professionals. One of our listeners in that group, Ronald Gate, moved to Miami after living in D.C., but he said he was disappointed by the job opportunities here and the lack of a vibrant tech and cultural scene. So his proposal, he said, if he were mayor, is that he would try to plug the brain drain by offering tax incentives for tech and cultural startups. What do you think of that idea?
Well, actually, I think I'm sorry he's disappointed, and I hope that he reconsiders moving from Miami. But there is the other side of the story. And the other side of the story is that we have young professionals moving into downtown, Brickell, Omni, Civic Center, Corridor. We have 20,000 new residents only in the downtown core of the city of Miami, which more than half are young professionals. And now with the Paris Museum, now with the Arch Center moving in the right direction for the last two or three years, with the new Science Museum, Museum Park, and all the downtown amenities, we have seen a lot of young people move into the city. A lot of young people are moving into Brickell as renters if they cannot afford to buy a condo just yet, in the Civic Center too. So
I'm sorry, one moment. Could I just want to check, because I want to make sure that everything is okay online. I was getting notes that maybe it's not. Is it working? Sorry, let me just make sure. Oh, you look fine now.
Well, thank you for saying that. You look fine.
You look good, actually, not just fine. I don't know why my video just went.
We're okay in here.
Okay, you know what? I'll just keep going. My video has gone out, though, but I'm sorry. Well, Mayor Regalado, continue.
I mean, the bottom line is that, you know, we aspire in the next two or three years to be like the next Manhattan. Downtown is becoming a 24/7 a style of life for many people, for many residents. We have seen just now with the New Year's Eve that we have 100,000 people at Bayfront Park just having a good time.
What are you doing to try and now keep those people here?
So what we are doing is that we are working with startups and tech companies in Wynwood, in Brickell. The city of Miami officially will be signing an agreement with Google so they can provide programming classes in some of our parks. We believe that we have built, we need to build the base from the bottom up with teenagers and of course offering incentive. Now, remember, we are a municipality. We cannot do what the federal government or the state government can do. But we do have community agencies that can offer tax breaks in terms of helping with the infrastructure, like the Community Redevelopment Agency that we have here in the Omni area, the CRA in Park West Overtown, the CRA in Midtown. And of course, we're doing a lot of things to have a better infrastructure in terms of having a better quality of life, so new businesses can come into the city.
So are those CRAs able to offer then some kind of credits, I guess, or incentives?
No, basically what they do is, let's say that you want to start a business in the Omni area. Well, then what they do is they help you with the tax increment money to do your connection to WASA, water and sewer, to do infrastructure, to fix the sidewalks, the streets. So it helps a lot with the cost. We are also working with the film industry to be more film friendly. But that's also a role that the state of Florida has to take.
I mean, you're right, that's going to be pretty difficult considering now the state tax incentives for film and television productions has been totally dried up now.
Right, and that's the point. My point is that we have to lobby the state because it makes sense for the state to give credits. I mean, if we have more film companies coming in to South Florida, and especially Miami, and trust me, they want to come to Miami, because the environment and the labor here is much better than even in Hollywood now, they will spend a lot of money. They will create a lot of jobs, good paying jobs.
So the city itself, though, can't provide these tax incentives, though, or in credits?
No, we cannot. We do help with waiving the permits costs, you know, helping with the police, helping with the street closure and all that, but in terms of tax breaks, we don't have the authority as a municipal government to say, well, you cannot or you shouldn't pay the sales tax, for instance.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, part of what makes a city appealing, which I think you've alluded to, is that it's more than just the financial incentive that you can give to a company. It's also what is it that we have to offer culturally and also in terms of our civic life. And one big area for what makes a place livable is its green spaces. And this is an idea that we received from one urban farmer. I'm going to play this clip for you. Actually, I'm going to need you to briefly take off your headphones just so you can hear this because I'm playing it from my laptop.
My name is Muriel, and I'm an urban farmer. If I were mayor of Miami, I would change all of the urban landscaping to become edible landscaping.
So I imagine fruit trees along Flagler Street might be a little bit difficult.
Free apple trees.
Orange trees,
or
probably.
Mangoes.
Mangoes, yeah, mangoes,
yeah,
avocados.
How about mangoes?
Right,
yeah.
We could have more.
No coconuts because, I mean, it's their...
The liability.
Liability.
Right. But
the huge liability.
But I think what Muriel's idea raises, actually, it relates to another good point about green space. We did have a lot of comments on Twitter from actually former County Mayor Javier Suarez and another Twitter account, Miami Mance, that public space should be a priority.
It is. It is, and it has. And let me tell you, something. Right, you know, a few steps from here, from this radio station, we have Museum Park. And Museum Park will be fantastic because it has the art museum, the science museum, and it will also have the city of Miami taking care of more than 20 acres of park, which is, I think, the only park in downtown Miami in the waterfront in the southeastern coast of the United States, as you know, south of New York. So what we are saying is that downtown it's going to have a spectacular park in Museum Park. But not only that, I mean, we are working with our Parks Department, and during my administration, actually, we started ecotourism tours in Simpson Park. Simpson Park is a very unique park, which is right smack into Brickell high rises, and is the only park in the state of Florida that has native plants. And we're bringing tourists to that park. We have Virginia Key, which we're working with. The different governments, now the county, it's partnering with us for the cleanup of what it used to be the old dump and the water plant in Virginia Key. And we have built in Virginia Key the bike trail. We have an ecotourism trail in Virginia Key that is fantastic. I myself have taken homeowners association. We provide transportation and we enroll homeowners groups, residents of the city of Miami, because I want them to know the crown jewels of the city of Miami.
And but what about trying to increase the amount of parks that are available? I know there was a study done by Trust for Public Land last year and the year before then. Miami ranked pretty low in terms of its park acreage per number of residents.
Yes, yes. And as a matter of fact, in the last 2 years, we have had the grand opening of two parks and at least two mini parks. Now we're working on several playgrounds and different parks to be enhanced. And what we want to do is to use the impact fees to try to buy some land so we can do more parks in the different districts of the city of Miami, because it's not only on the Brickell Biscayne area. We need parks throughout the city of Miami. My goal in the next 4 years is to have a park or a mini park within walking distance of any neighborhood.
What, the two parks that you mentioned that you're working on, where are those parks? These are new parks that you're working on.
Yeah, right? Last year we have the new Brickell Park, which is a place that is being used in an incredible way by residents of Brickell on 18th Road. And then we have the Flatiron Park here on Mary Brickell that has been worked on it. We have a proposal for two parks, one in the Rhodes area and also in the Golden Pines area by US 1 on 32nd Avenue. So these are components, and what we are doing is we are asking developers, well, actually we have another park that I miss related it's building a condo building in the bay by Edgewater, about 15 blocks from here in the Omni area, and they have provided a park, and they will be building and paying for a park as part of the covenant to build their condo. Also on Biscayne on 36, a new developer has partnered with the city of Miami to enhance what used to be just a site and convert it into a park.
I mean, and actually kind of on that topic then, I mean, the parks, our current parks, have been in the news a lot because of the contamination that has been found in these parks. And I think just last month there were two more Miami parks that were closed for testing. You've said that this is a problem that you inherited, but I think the Herald and New York Times have found that about at least 2 years ago the city knew about contamination in the West Grove area by the old Smoky incinerator, but the city didn't do anything about that. How do you explain that?
Well, the reason that we didn't do, or as a matter of fact, I don't think that that's a correct statement, that we didn't do anything. What happened was that we were told that the remediation that was done several years ago when Blanche Park was built was the right thing to do at the time by DERM. Now, DERM came back and said, well, you know, you have to go 2 feet down because we found that there was, you know, traces of glasses and other.
And when is this, when you're saying that DERM came back and said?
Just recently now.
Right.
When we decided.
But when the initial amount of contamination was found, and then I guess this is when you put the AstroTurf
exactly,
in there.
And
but was the public notified that that was the reason for why the AstroTurf was put there?
Well, actually, I don't know if the public was notified, but that's the remedy that we were asked at that time by DERM. And we were followed that directive. Now, we have received words that some of the parks that we were told that were contaminated are not, in terms of the danger zone. So now we are moving forward with the cleanup of Blanche Park, Merry Christmas Park, and by the way, the county will be helping the city in, on the cleanup because the expensive part is not the cleanup, it's to dispose of the land that needs to be removed.
But so, what about in the West Grove, though? Because in the West Grove, the city found out that there was contamination when they were putting up that fire department training facility, but they didn't let the community know that there was this contamination found there, and they didn't do testing of the nearby parks there either.
Yeah, well, 35 years ago.
Right? No, 2 years ago. Two, three years ago. This is recent. This is under your term.
No, I understand what you're saying, but what I'm saying is that at the time, we did what we were asked to be done. That, on the fire training center, the fire training center was there, has been there for 35 years. When the first thing that we knew was Blanche Park in sort of the center growth, and then we just proceed with the closure of the park, and then with the remedy, and working on it. But you know, if you go around Miami-Dade County, you will go to West Kendall or South Dade, and you will find the same, because in the past, trash used to be burned in many places in Miami-Dade County. Just the focus is in the city of Miami, and we are glad, and we're happy to do it. I mean, when we built 7 years ago Graveland Park, which is a water park,
where there was also contamination found, that Miami New Times found that the city knew that there was contamination
three years ago,
that the county had asked the city to monitor the groundwater there, groundwater which is used for the water park, and the city didn't follow up and do that testing.
Oh, no, we did. I was on the city commission, and I was part
of... I'm talking about post-2010, so once you were mayor.
Oh, no, but no. And that is wrong information, because we paid $8 million to remedy Graveland Park. And after we did the remedy, Durham came in and gave us a clean bill. So, you know, if they want to come back now and say, well, you know, we think... By the way, the Miami-Dade Health Department has come up, as you know, with a lot of input in this issue, and has determined that there is no threat for people or children that used to go to Blanche Park and Merry Christmas Park.
Along the lines when we were talking about the West Grove, kind of a broader question. I mean, your strongest supporters have generally been Spanish speakers, especially who are senior citizens. Taking that into account, how do you respond to the perception that that you're more the mayor for the Hispanic and especially older communities? How do you show that you are also a mayor for the non-Hispanic Miamians?
Well, I'm very proud to say that I won every area of the city of Miami, not on this last election, which was an easy election, but on my first election, and I have been active in every corner of the city of Miami, from Model City and Overtown to the West Grove or to Flagami or to Alapata. And let me tell you about the West Grove. I have been working with some of the developers, trying to get the developers and the residents together. And finally, it seems that we are moving in the right direction on the redevelopment of Grand Avenue.
Including the trolley garage issue?
Well, I mean, the trolley garage issue, I think is something that has to be dealt in terms of Miami-Dade County, Coral Gables, and Miami. If it were for me, I wouldn't have the trolley garage there. Because it doesn't belong there. But by the way, that area is zone industrial. So it's anybody with a muffler company comes in and wants to establish itself, there's no way that the city cannot approve that, because by right they can do it. So hopefully the trolley issue will resolve outside court, and probably the city of Corregay will decide to abandon the site and go somewhere. But you know, the city did not violate any law in terms of zoning when the issue was approved. Do I want something of that kind in the city of Miami that doesn't belong here because it serves Corregay? No, I don't. But it was done by right.
So for some residents, parks are their home. I'm talking about the homeless. Why is it that the city has been seeking more power to arrest homeless people for misdemeanors that are kind of unavoidable if you're homeless, like loitering or sleeping on the sidewalks?
Actually, we don't want to arrest them. We just wanted to take them to a shelter. We want them to sleep on a bed under a roof, instead of sleeping on the sidewalks and getting killed or getting mugged or getting a knife by another homeless or by a crook. And you know, for years the city of Miami has been paying the sins of the past. Back in the 80s, the homeless were arrested without cause and their property destroyed, so a federal court impose rulings on the city of Miami that we had to respect, that is known as the Pottinger case. What the city is seeking is that we have the ability to go to that person and say, look, we have a bed available for you to spend the night. And then you can go on with your life when you wake up and take a bath and have breakfast in the morning. What the city cannot do that now is because of the Pottinger ruling, that the court says you cannot take a homeless to a shelter unless you have you provide long-term medical and psychological care, which doesn't exist because it costs a lot of money.
But what could the city do? I mean, could the city do something about the fact that it's not available? I mean, could the city try and provide that long-term medical care itself, or look for ways to do that?
It's impossible. It is impossible because not even Camilo's house, which is to me one of the examples of care for the homeless in a human way, can do it. You cannot commit to a long-term psychological and physical health care for a person. I mean, you're talking people with catastrophic illness and all that. So what we want to do is just get them off the streets at night, take them to the human thing. And as a commissioner, I was a member of the Homeless Trust, which I'm still are as a mayor, and I was able to do the indoor feeding because 8 years ago there were people that come in with good hearts from churches, from Davie or Coral Gables, and will park their vans on the street near American Airlines Arena or in somewhere in downtown, and hand them plastic plates, and they will just sit on the sidewalk with the mud and eat. So we wanted to do something human for the homeless, and we organized the indoor feedings, and we did, and it worked. And now what we want to do, what we're asking the courts, what the city commission is going to be hopefully approving tomorrow, the agreement that we have with the LCLU, is that the city of Miami Police Department will be able to go to these people when they're sleeping on the sidewalk and say, you can block the sidewalk. You cannot block the sidewalk. We have an option for you. Now, if you refuse several times, you will be arrested, but that's a misdemeanor. You cannot do your psychological things on the street and be aggressive, panhandling on the people, we need to take you to a shelter. So it is important that people see this as the human way to treat the homeless instead of harassing the homeless. And by the way, the LCLU, which is the leading defender of the homeless, has agreed with the city in this agreement that we hope that the federal court would approve. So it will give the city flexibility to bring these people out on the streets and into a decent bed.
But then what's the long-term solution then? I mean, because just putting them into a shelter with a 3-inch thick mat is not a long-term solution for homelessness.
The long-term solution is the 10-year plan of the Homeless Trust, which has a budget of $25 million, something like that, most of them from Washington and the rest from the tax that was created in the restaurants here in Miami-Dade County to have transitional housing and to have, and trust me, I mean, unfortunately, the media focus on the 800 homeless that we have still in Miami-Dade County and the 500 that we have in downtown Miami. But 7 years ago, we had 8,000 homeless. And most of these people are now no more homeless. They are living in transitional housing in downtown Miami or in Homestead in the Air Force Base. So we feel that we can do so more for the homeless. I mean, long terms, you know, you have the hack in Miami Avenue on 15th Street. That's a model. You have families that have been evicted from their homes because they can no longer afford to pay the rent. And these people can stay there as a family until they get back on their feet. We found them because the city of Miami has the Green Church, which is a homeless unit of the NED office, and we find these people living on the expressway on their cars with a little barbecue, changing diapers at night and taking a bath with the hose, and we house them not only in the center but also in motels using federal funds. So the big story here, I think it's been missed, is that many homeless people are no longer homeless in Miami-Dade County and especially in the city of Miami.
And on that subject though, of law enforcement, last summer an investigation by the Federal Department of Justice found that the city of Miami Police Department engaged in a quote, pattern or practice of using excessive force, end quote, and cited the killings of 7 black men that occurred within a period of a few months during your first term. Since that report, what has the city done to prevent police misconduct that had been cited in that report?
Well, first of all, I'd like to say that I was the one that requested the investigation from DOJ, from the Department of Justice. I and Congresswoman Frederica Wilson wrote to the Attorney General of the United States asking for an investigation on the possible violation of civil rights. Several of these cases had been solved by the state attorney of Miami-Dade County, and the officers have been found innocent. But having said that, we wanted the DOJ to step in. I will say that 90% of what the Department of Justice has said that the city has to do, we already done. The chief of police already has implemented the protocols that DOJ decided that they were the right thing to do.
Could you list some of those protocols? What are some of the things that have been
well,
done?
For instance, more training in terms of when you're going to draw a weapon. That's important. Dismantling the units were like dressed in civilian clothing and unmarked cars going around at midnight, jumping up the SUVs with assault rifles, and Also, the different ways of treating traffic stops. So it's all about training and of course removing from the streets officers that had a pass of you know, drawing their weapons in different times in an unnecessary way. So all of these all of the things have been implemented with the new chief of police. That, you know, he's been there for almost 3 years now, but I think he has turned around the department. The only thing, the only component missing, and we are going to be meeting with the DOJ and going to court, is for the court to certify those measures that have been taken, because the DOJ said, well, you know, we're very happy with what this chief has done, but what if we have a new chief and they decided to change the whole thing? So now we have the issue of certifying by the court these actions that the chief has taken, and also the creation of a monitor. A monitor will be in charge, an independent monitor will be in charge of supervising that those DOJ measures have been adhered to.
But I thought last August the police chief had told the DOJ that a monitor was not necessary.
It is. We believe that it isn't, and the chief believed that it isn't because he has implemented. However, if the court says for you to comply, you need to have a monitor, well, we have a monitor.
And so, how much, do you know how much that will cost?
We don't know, but it will be expensive because the monitor has to have, you know, a staff to work with the chief of police. But you know, we have peace in the community. That worth millions of dollars. We have established relationships with the community that there's never been a time in the city of Miami in the past that we have so great relations with all the communities and the police department. In fact, I have partnered with the chief of police and the city of Miami Police Department and my office and the department. We have done several gun buybacks. And we have taken off the streets almost 600 weapons, including assault weapons. And the community, it's coming to us every time that we do this. We just did that 1 month ago. So relations have never been better.
And actually, so on that topic of relationships with the community, we did get an idea from a listener, Gerald Katz of Miami, who proposed that this Civilian Complaint Review Board, which I think is called Civilian Investigative Panel,
correct,
that it become more robust and be given more authority to investigate. I think right now there's a statute, there's a limitations period for how long their investigations can be. Is this something that you might consider doing?
Well, this panel is a charter agency of the city of Miami. What it means is that it was approved by the voters. It's the only board in the city of Miami that was approved by the board, the creation of the boards. And it came as a result of the Elian Gonzalez riots in 2000 and some problems in the African-American community. It does have teeth. All the chief of police historically, not the chief, actually the one that we have now, have fought the panel because they think that they don't need an oversight panel. This panel has more powers than the one that the county has, than the one that any panel in the state of Florida. They do not have the power to fire a police officer, for instance. They can only recommend to the chief.
Whereas this Miami's panel can?
Right. Miami panel cannot.
Okay.
There's no panel in the U.S. that can fire.
So what powers does the Miami panel have that make them stronger than...
It has the panel. The panel has the power of subpoena. It has investigators. It has the power to recommend to the chief what action should be taken in different cases. The problem that we have with this panel is that there is an issue with the union and with the state law and the police officers that they are protected, and you cannot follow, or you cannot do a whole investigation if Internal Affairs is doing another investigation. So they have to wait. So that's a quagmire that this panel faces, and that should be resolved by the legislature. The state legislature should define, because we don't have the authority as a municipal government, what powers does a civilian investigative panel has in term of enforcing the law with the police department.
Another area that I wanted to talk about is, I mean, you've said that the balancing the budget is one of your biggest accomplishments, because I know it's always a very difficult thing, especially with Miami's financial history. But the city has repeatedly declared a state of financial urgency, and I mean, in 2012 when it did
not
it.
Not anymore.
Not, that's true. Not in 2013. We did not do it. In 2012 when we did it, though, just a few months later, the finance department found a $45 million surplus, which I think critics have sometimes brought up as an example of the lack of professionalism in City Hall. What do you say to that?
Well, what I say to that is I would read to you what Bloomberg just wrote yesterday with the new outlook of our bond project.
Our credit rating right now is A2, right? I think with a negative outlook. Is it
no, positive.
Positive, and it's
yes,
been changed.
It was negative until last November. Now is positive, and I consider that a huge advance in terms. And you know, Bloomberg said today, Miami has a much more positive story to tell than they have had any time in the last 5 years, and because you know, because we not only have balanced the budget, we have raised the reserve from 13 millions when I became mayor to 75 millions today.
Oh, that's still less than what is, isn't it supposed to be 20% of the operating budget is what's supposed to be in the reserve?
It is our own ordinance. It's not required by the bond ratings agency.
Right.
We said that we should have 95%. And by the way, I think we're going to get there. And we're going to get there. 95
million.
And I think that we're going to get there because we want to show Wall Street that we can do it, not because we have to. We have $75 million now in the reserve. When in 2003, we have $141 million in the reserve, and then it went downhill. And when I got to the mayor's office in November 2009, we had $13 million only in the reserve. So I think it's important that people recognize that not only we have reduced taxes, and we have increased services, but we have been able to increase the reserve. And that is S&P just changed the outlook for Miami November 26 from negative to positive. Fitch just did it a few weeks ago. And to me, this is important. Now, we have in place a finance team for almost a year and a half, which, by the way, has been looked as a very positive step by the rating agencies. And we are on the way to be rated much, much better than we were in the last, not only in the last 4 years, but in the last 8 years of the administration.
And another revenue idea, possibly, that came from one of our listeners, came from Ellen Haas of Miami. She proposed that Miami institute a congestion tax or charge that would be a fee that drivers would pay whenever they came into the center of the city during peak hours, and this could possibly fund some transportation improvements like protected bike lanes. What do you say to that?
Well, I remember that it was my first years in the city commission in 1996. The city went into a crisis that the governor had to step in, and there was a huge deficit, and the city was almost bankrupt. And one of the things that was considered by the oversight board was like New York has, like a tax to come into downtown. It was determined that the city cannot do that.
That was in I guess the 90s is what you're talking
about.
In the 90s. Right, but how about now?
How about now? You still cannot do it because for several reasons. You cannot tax the people in the expressway that are coming to the city of Miami because it's a agency that owns the expressway. Biscayne Boulevard is a state road, so you cannot do it. We have in the city of Miami the parking surcharge, which is exclusive of the city of Miami. Every time that you park in any parking, private or official, in the city of Miami, the city of Miami gets a parking surcharge. Remember that we have, as we approve as resident of Miami-Dade County, half a penny increase on the sales tax for transportation. And the city of Miami has used that not only to fix streets and sidewalks, but to operate the trolley system. Now, the trolley system, it's free, and I'm proud to say that during my administration, we have grown. We started the system during my watch, and now we are transporting more than 7,000 people a day on the trolley, free. And we think that we have helped the congestion in Brickell and in downtown Miami, and we're serving not only the resident but tourists. But I will say to you, 90% of the people that ride the trolleys are City of Miami residents or visitors that work in downtown and Brickell.
Now, to go to a very different point, I mean, Miami is the entry point for so many immigrants, and our city is thriving because of our connections with Latin America. So I think it wasn't a surprise that during this project, we did hear a lot from people wishing that Miami could do more to help undocumented immigrants. Understandably, the city of Miami does not control our nation's immigration policy, but what can you do within what the purview is of the mayor's office? What can you do to help undocumented immigrants?
Well, for one thing, the city of Miami Police Department doesn't do like some other police departments throughout the United States do. And they stop people and ask for documents. If they're undocumented, they call INS or ICE, as they call it now. We don't. If you take a red light or if you create an accident, you'll be fine. And your problem is to go to court. If you don't have a driver's license, you will be cited, and you have to go to court. If you skip court, then it's your problem. The other thing that we're doing is we're partnering with the church. Catholic Charities did a drive to help people to become residents and citizens, and we do that. I think it's important, and we have done it, to go lobby Congress, because I believe that immigration reform not only is the right thing to do, not only is the human thing to do, but it's the intelligent thing to do. There is a, when we got the census results, we had to challenge it because we believe that we have much more people living in the city of Miami, and just because of fear, those people didn't wanted to be counted. And it's important because we get our federal funding from Washington depending on the number of residents. The rescue service of the city of Miami is the highest number of calls service in all South Florida. We do, I think, 69,000 calls a year in terms of a rescue, and we serve everyone. We don't ask when we pick up somebody in the street because of an accident or an illness, we don't ask for papers. We just take them to the hospital and deal with that. So I think that the time has come to local leaders to be more proactive in Washington, demanding that there is an immigration reform, because, what are you going to do? You're going to deport millions of people? You can. So might as well let them pay taxes, let them become real residents in the United States, follow the law, and make a new life for themselves. I'm willing to do it. I have done it. They just don't care about what I have to say. But I think it's important that local leaders start being more proactive in Washington about immigration reform.
And another idea that we got from a listener, Gloria Lewis, she proposed that the mayors should have town hall meetings at least once a month so everyone can share their input.
Twice a month.
Oh, she's saying once a month. She'd be happy with once a month.
Well, I do it twice a month.
You do?
Yes.
Where?
Well, see, in the city of Miami, we have Homeowners Association. We have the Shenandoah Homeowners Association, the Silver Bluff, the Golden Pines, the Upper East Side, Belle Mead, Shortcrest. I go to those town hall meetings.
Are those meetings though open to everyone though?
Open to everyone. And actually, I would like to say that I'm very proud because during my campaign, in the last 10 months, I've done meet and greets in all the condos in the downtown corridor. And I met, not everybody went. But when you do one of those town halls or meet and greet, you got 50 people and you're happy. But there were at least 50 people in every building. And every month I attend myself. And my staff, at least two or three homeowners association in the city of Miami. We have more than 20, and they meet once every 2 months or once a month. And I think it's important because they get to talk to the mayor and challenge the mayor and say, I have a pothole, I have local flooding in front of my house, or somebody's house was robbed, and we take notes. And to me, that's an experience. I do Crime Watch too. I meet just in a corner with some residents, from Flagami to Alapata, and it really works. I just like people, and I did that as a commissioner for 13 years. And I will continue to do it. I don't have any more elections, but I will continue to go to the Homeowners Association, the meet and greet. The lady wants one, I do twice.
Great. She'll be happy to hear it then. And I think this is a good question that we can end with then. So what are your goals for this term? I mean, how do you want to be remembered?
I want to be remembered as the mayor who raised the quality of life of the city of Miami and of the resident. I want to be remembered by the mayor who allowed every resident in the city of Miami to get out of their homes at 10 a.m. in the morning or at 10 p.m. at night and walk the streets of any neighborhoods in the city of Miami and not only be safe, but feel safe. And I think that's important because, the big buildings are great. The museums and the bridges and the expressways are part of the era of progress. But the most important asset that a city has is their residents. And I want to be remembered as the mayor that gave the residents of Miami the best quality of life that they ever had.
So what do you need to accomplish that this term? What are your goals?
Safety for the residents. We have increased the budget of the police department to hire more police officers. Quality of life in terms of infrastructure, fixing sidewalks so people can jog and walk without falling, fixing the streets so not only cars but bicycles can ride on the streets of the city of Miami, have more lights in the different neighborhoods. We are working with Florida Power and Light to have more lights in terms of what we need in the neighborhoods, and especially to provide jobs for the city residents. You know, I am in my watch. You know, we had an unemployment rate of 10.5, I think it was, when I came into the mayor's office. I'm happy to say that the Department of Labor Statistics of the Department of Labor on the 31st of January said officially that the unemployment rate for the city of Miami was 6.3. In 2012 was 6.7. At the end of 2013 was 6.3. My goal is to have on 2014, at the end of 2014, a 5%. And, you know...
What are you going to do to try and get it to 5%?
Well, actually, we are doing a lot. And what we are doing is we are... hopefully, we'll be certified by the United States State Department as an investor visa regional center. And that's a federal law that allows the foreign investor to invest $1 million with the caveat that you have to create 10 permanent jobs directly or indirectly, and with that you get your green card. And this is working now very well in the city of Dallas. Hopefully we will be the second city in the U.S. to own an investor visa regional center. We know for a fact, because we have been approached, that we have more than 100 million out there of people that want to invest in Miami if they get their green card for them and their family. That would mean 1,000 jobs. But when we finish those private projects like Brickell City Center, which has an exemption to work in the construction 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, by late 2014, the first phase will be done. We will have 4,000 new jobs, permanent jobs, in those shopping centers, restaurants, hotels, condos, etc. So Miami is poised to be a global city, but a global city needs to have low unemployment. Hopefully. And thankfully, the voters of Miami decided, Miami-Dade County decided, that they needed to support the bond issue for the school board. And we have 53 public schools in the city of Miami. And those schools, which are very old, will be remodeled and redone. So that would bring more quality of life to the residents. So it's a combination, and we will hope to, like I said, I'm telling you that my goal is to have 5% unemployment at the end of 2014.
And I just want to step back, I mean, because people have even been criticizing Governor Scott for trying to take on take some credit for the jobs that have been created in the state of Florida, saying really what role did the governor have in that? I mean, how do you know that you had some role in reducing the unemployment from 10% to 6 point, I can't remember the number you gave, but 6.3%. I mean, what role did you have in doing that?
It wasn't me only. It was the private sector. The government doesn't create jobs. Private sector does. But the role of the government is to help private sector and step out of the way. Don't complicate things for them. But we do have a role. We have a workforce office that is training people in Overtown. We have this regional center that if we get a certified, which hopefully it would be early this year, we will be able to direct investment and create 10 jobs for every $1 million invested in the city of Miami. That's a doing of the government.
But in your first term, that approximately 4% reduction in unemployment, what role did you have in that?
I think the climate, for instance, 3 years reducing taxes, that brought a lot of developers back to Miami. Today, on my first 4 years, we have 47 projects of construction, major projects of construction, most of them condos and shopping centers in the city of Miami. Going back to city center, the biggest private commercial construction in the United States of America today, it's Brickell Center. So the role that we have play is to reduce taxes, to be developer friendly, to take care of the people that really want to invest and create jobs in the city of Miami, to not to create obstacles, but to try to help. If it's if you do it by the book, do it by the book, but help the people that want to bet on Miami. And I think that our policy of reducing taxes has led to many, many, many millions of dollars of investment in the city of Miami, because you know, people with money know where to put their money, and they know that when they see the trend that you have a municipal government of a major metropolitan city reducing taxes 1 year after the year after the year for 3 years and expanding services, this is the place to come. So part of the responsibility is our, although we won't be able to claim anything without the private sector.
Well, thank you so much, Mayor Regalado, for giving us your time and to our online audience as well. On our website next week, you can join us for our interview with Hialeah Mayor Carlos Hernandez. These interviews are part of our If I Were Mayor project, which is supported by the Miami Foundation as part of their ongoing work to build a more civically engaged Miami. Thank you very much, Mayor Regalado.
Thank you.
Okay. Let me just... Have you ever spent so much time on YouTube?
Actually, no.